until about 6:47, a quarter to seven. There is something about it that we did. There is a special prayer, the two actual prayers, one called Salatul Khusuf for the Qamar or Salatul Khusuf for the moon. The brother will ask, I was surprised, many people didn't know. Actually, I was standing with a few brothers here and I was surprised. Yani, for a long time, they didn't have any idea about it. And even when I came here around 4 or 5 o'clock. Nobody was here. I thought they didn't announce it here. In some of the masajid, they did. If you see, if you are following the what called post on different website, even ISNA, I was like surprised that ISNA website actually had news about the clips of this prayer at Masjid al-Farooq and different masajid, but not ISNA. And this is why nobody related to it to ISNA. Anyway, when I came here in the morning, nobody was here. I had to wait in the car because I was not sure whether I have the correct code for opening this building. Because once you go wrong, it will start calling the fire department and so on. So I stayed outside until the brothers start coming. By the time the first three or four brothers came, we were just a few people. So I told them, let's pray. I mean, we don't know the people, we don't have the announcement. So alhamdulillah, we did it. Then the Fajr prayer, the Azan was called, Sheikh Muhammad came. And Sheikh Muhammad himself came a little earlier because he said, I came thinking that we are going to pray Salatul Khusuf or Khusuf al-Qamar. Now, but because that was the time for the Fard prayer, so we prayed Fajr, and then after Fajr, we prayed again Salatul, like this Khusuf. Right? Now, what is Khusuf? What happened? And so on and so on and so on. One, taban, among the signs of Allah that Allah spoke about, you know, I went through the internet to take the word Al-Qamar. You know, things that have to do is the moon. So I went 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23 places in the Quran. These are the chapters, the places where the moon was mentioned. Even there is a whole chapter, you know, in the Quran is titled Surah Al-Qamar. Alhamdulillah, this is what Sheikh Ali Hindi led us in prayer. So actually, in the part that we prayed, he read from Surah Al-Qamar. Actually, he read all of Surah Al-Qamar. Let me now roll you back of how this happened. What is the, yani, what we call the fiqh of it, what to do and so on and so on. For those of you who know it, alhamdulillah, it's a reminder. Allah says, Zakir, remind them again, إِنَّ الذِّكْرَ تَنْفَعَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. A believer always benefits from reminders. And especially for things that Allah repeats. Everybody reads Surah Al-Fatiha how many times a day for prayers, for this, for that. We repeat things and so on. Sometimes there's a hikmah behind this. So if you knew it, it's just a reminder. If you didn't, pay attention. Now, the story started this way and then came the fiqh about it. It is a special prayer. Now, they said during the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when his son Ibrahim passed away, Ibrahim was a baby. Then there was an eclipse of the sun. Okay, when the eclipse took place, people started talking, saying that this is because the Prophet's son died. The eclipse happened because of the son's, the Prophet's son Ibrahim alayhi salam died. The Prophet was quick to correct this. He said that the moon and the sun, al-shams wal-qamar ayatan, these are signs from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they don't like eclipse because of a death or a birth of a person, which means he ruled out even that his son died. He wants to clear this very clear. But he said these are signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they require a special prayer. And actually he prayed, he led that prayer and he prayed it. Now, Salatul Khusuf or Salatul Khusuf is similar. They are just, you pray two rakahs. Like just like any sunnah prayer, you make turakas. What is unique about it is that in every rak'ah, there are two ruku'. Right? Two ruku'. Let me describe it to you. You say Allahu Akbar, and then they prolong the reading because it takes the time the eclipse wavers. Yeah. Sometimes it takes. Today, according to the reports, like from 7:15 to about 8, it didn't take much really. And you can say it's within an hour. But sometimes it takes a long time, a long time. I think when I was young, 50 years or 40 years ago, more than 40 years, there was an eclipse. And the Imam started with Surah Al-Baqarah. He finished all of Surah Al-Baqarah. And then he went to Surah Ali Imran because the eclipse was there. And you can go on and on and on until the eclipse clears. Right? So the way it is prayed is very simple. It's a regular prayer. The difference is this, that you say Allahu Akbar, طبعاً you make تكبيرة الإحرام, you read Surah Al-Fatiha, you read Surah, like you prolong it. And then when you finish the Surah, normally you go for ruku', right? Then after ruku', we go for sujood, normally. In Salatul Kusuf or Khusuf, that's not the way. Like you finished, like you read, say, half Surah Al-Baqarah, you said Allahu Akbar, you came back, you start reading again. You don't go to sujood. It means there are two ruku' in it. In the same rak'ah, there are two. And then you continue until you read as much as they read, and then you can make the sujood. So basically, the difference is that you make a ruku', and then you come out of the ruku', and instead of going for sujood, you continue reading again, start Surah Al-Fatiha and roll it again, and then in the second one, then you do it, and do it for the second one. Clear? Now, this is about this incident, and this is what the fiqh about it is. What's interesting is, as I said to you, this long list of the chapters. So I want you really to go with me. I tell you why I personally thought this would be interesting to know about Shamsu al-Qamar. We start with Ibrahim alayhi salam. This is in Surah Al-An'am, chapter 6, verse 77, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about Ibrahim. He said, فَلَمَّا رَأَى الْقَمَرَ بَازِقًا قَالَ هَذَا رَبِّي فَلَمَّا أَفَلَ قَالَ لَمْ يَهْدِينَ رَبِّي لَا كُنَّ مِنْ قَوْمِ الضَّالِينَ. In his search for Allah, Ibrahim alayhi salam looked at the stars, right? And when he looked at the stars, he thought this is God. Just like people now, you know, people worship cows, there's some very sad news that a cow was shipped from India to Qatar, not to Bahrain, especially Marat, and they have a big temple, actually two cows, one black, one white, and they had a big hailing for it. And unfortunately, Muslims were... And these are things that are happening, unfortunately, in Muslim countries now. So Ibrahim went in search for the moon, right? Sorry, for the stars. He said, when he saw the star, he thought this is Allah. So he waited there, and then the star by the day, by the way, the stars don't disappear. The sun covers it, so you don't see the stars during the day. Right? They say when you have really trouble with your wife, okay. Anyway, so when the daylight came, you can't see the stars during the daylight. And what has happened, Ibrahim alayhi salam said, فَلَمَّا أَفَلَ قَالَ لَا أُحِبُّ الْآفِلِينَ. يعني God cannot be something that disappears. So then he came to this verse that we read it for you. فَلَمَّا رَأَى الْقَمَرَ بَازِقًا. Then he saw the moon. قَالَ هَذَا رَبِّي. فَلَمَّا أَفَلَ قال لئن لم يهديني ربي لأكونن من القوم الضالين. طيب. So when he saw the moon and the moon said, this is bigger, it's brighter, but it disappeared as well. So he said, if Allah does not guide me, I'll not be guided anyway. Then Allah said, then he saw the sun. And then when he saw the sun, قال هذا ربي هذا أكبر. Like the sun is bigger than that. Also when it disappeared, he said, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of course, guided him. This is the first verse. Now, the second verse. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about this in Surah Al-An'am. فالق الإصباح. الإصباح is the morning. Like, you know, the morning becomes a satellite. The light gets into night and day. وجعل الليل سكنا والشمس والقمر حسبانا. Like the moon and the star were made for us to do our calculations. By the way, this is the best that many people who go for astronomy, not astrology. In Ramadan, normally people do not make a distinction between astrology and astronomy. Astrology is just tahmin, like people have this. Astronomy is a science, studied, monitored, and so on. There are, in America here, by the way, there is a group of astronomers, Muslim astronomers. They monitor the moon every month around the year in about 53 positions in America here. Because they monitor when the moon, first sighting, register, and so on. Anyway, that's going to become, inshallah, one of the things in Ramadan. So they use this verse that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَالشَّمْسُ وَالْقَمَرَ حُسْبَانَ. طيب. In Surah Al-A'raf, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, A'raf chapter 7, إِنَّ رَبَّكُمُ اللَّهِ Your Lord is Allah. الَّذِي خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ فِي سِتَّةِ أَيَّامٍ ثُمَّ اسْتَوَى عَلَى الْعَرْشِ يُخْشِي اللَّيْلَ النَّهَارَ يَطْلُبُهُ حَثِيثًا وَالشَّمْسُ والقمر والنجوم مسخرات بأمره ألا له الخلق والأمر تبارك الله رب العالمين ادعوا ربكم تضرعا وخفيا الله said this. So Allah speaks about the moon, the sun, the stars and so on. He says these are also signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Allah tells us how it cycles. طيب. In Surah Yunus chapter 10 Allah says هو الذي جعل الشمس ضياء والقمر نورا. By the way, again, we talked about the miracles of the Quran. 14 centuries ago, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent this verse to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said to him, the sun, siraj. Siraj means source of light. Al-qamar, like al-qamar is not siraj. Al-qamar nur. Al-qamar reflects the light of the sun. So the moon does not have light of itself. And this is why the eclipse is actually when the earth comes in between, and this is what happened this morning. طيب. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, هو الذي جعل الشمس ضياء والقمر وقدره منازل لتعلموا عدد السنين والحساب. Now, people who used to say, unfortunately, and this used to be, alhamdulillah, it's changed, they say you cannot do any calculations or anything. This is wrong. Because Allah mentioned this in the Quran. That you have to calculate, you have to do this. Surprisingly, people use a hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about moon sighting. When they say, the Prophet said, إِنَّا أُمَّةٌ أُمِّيَّ لَا نَحْسِبْ وَلَا نَقْرَأ. Well, he didn't mean that we don't. I mean, how many faculties of mathematics, how many professors of math we have. That's not what is meant by this. It meant that the Prophet said, this deen is not for people as professors in Cambridge or Harvard. This is for everyone. If you don't have to calculate, just go out and see the moon and when it's good. But if you have more accurate things of doing it, what can stop people from doing this? And alhamdulillah, over the last, I mean, 10 years now, 20 years, when we had this astronomical conference, I told you in Washington, D.C., and we tried really to go to the bottom of it. I know this, we don't talk about it in Ramadan because Ramadan is sensitive. I can talk about it now so that we don't have feelings about it, right? For years, even here in America, in Canada and so on, in the early days, when I say early days, I'm talking about 45 years ago. When he just came, in those days, I remember we had Jami Masjid, we called Saudi Arabia, very simple. Some brothers we know or some people, they say, okay, the moon is being sighted. Then we go, we announce it, khalas, Ramadan and fasting. And then the fights start breaking because some people say, this is not true in a different zone. Hanafi say something, Shafi say something else. And then the community starts breaking. And we used to have one group fasting the first day, the second day, sometimes go 3 days of fasting. Eid, oh, biggest problem. That one day in this. And so this used to spin us during the months of Ramadan. But there was no other thing. Only you had phone call. I remember one of the incidents I cannot forget. We had a brother here who was studying at McMaster University. So when he went to there, he became our contact. I could call him. Is it determined? Because those days, you don't have this, what you call cell phones, and you can get things just like this everywhere. So I didn't find him. As a matter of fact, I found his mom. So I said, Salaam alaikum, alaikum salam. My name is Abdullah. She said, yes, we didn't see you, but my son always talk about you and so on. I said to her, where is like your son? He said, he's not there. He went to pray Taraweeh. So she said to me, do you need anything? I said, nah, khalas, I got it. Because if you went to pray Taraweeh, ma lakhas Ramadan. So things like this used to happen to us. Now, gradually, gradually. But then I'm putting you, this is very interesting when I go through these verses. Gradually, we had this group of young Muslim astronomers. There are four famous all of them. Some of the brothers well don't know them. One of them is this Durrani. He was at Cornell University. Omar Ashqar was in University of Chicago. And then we have, what's his name? Shawkat. He used to work with US Navy. And then we have another brother. I'm trying to remember his name. So these were the brothers who went and studied astronomy. At the time, we had the MS. So they said, used to meet with us and tell us, you people are really far behind. This is now science. It's not astrology. There is this, there is that, there is that, there is that. And then Quran started people also dividing on it. It became very strong, I remember, around 1984, when the community started breaking along these lines. And people go to universities and so on and so on. They think, why do we have to go back in this village things and so on and so on. So the idea came, why don't we really look into it? You know, one of the things that, alhamdulillah, this is a good thing here in America, is that when people come with genuine arguments, people want to try it. Why not? So they called for an international conference on moon sighting in Washington, D.C. And they asked people to come writing papers, just a form. I don't know where the papers are, I had them here. And we actually got people to start working on it. And we had presentations from all the people who work in space. I remember we invited a professor from Harvard University. We had one professor from NASA, and they cost us a lot of money. Because these people to appear for 3 hours, they demand $10,000. Not like this is big for free and go. And then we got somebody from US Navy, Canadian actually Navy, because they one of the earliest moon sightings happened here in Canada. The earliest. So we got this. We got a brother from Malaysia. I don't know if you know Dr. Elias, Muhammad Elias. Elias used to be the chair of the, they have a faculty, college at the International University of Malaysia, and it's titled Faculty of Revealed Science. Revealed science. They study the Quran, study the Hadith, they study this and so on. And he published about 16 books on moon sighting, especially about astronomy. He tried to make it easier for people. We invited him as well. Then we invited the people like Mac Loughlin here. There was a professor called Gruger. He's not a Muslim, a Canadian. And then somebody from Chicago. Chicago has this, they call it Adler Planetarium. And then they have another planetarium in Louisiana, what's the city in Louisiana, the major city there. So they invited all of these people to come to Washington. And we invited all the imams at the time. They spent a lot of money to do this, by the way. Because to bring people all over, to bring speakers and so on. Now, in that conference, three things came clear. That all of these people agreed unanimously, Muslims, non-Muslims, and so on, that the birth of the moon, remember the word, the birth of the moon is determined by an increment of a second. The birth of the moon. I'll tell you then how we tested that. They said the birth of the moon is no question that you know when the moon, astronomers know it's something done. Where they differed is the sighting of the moon. See, yani all of them said, this is the time when the moon is born, worldwide. But the sighting, they have variations of it. By the way, there is a scholar, Muslim, you all know Ibn Taymiyyah. Ibn Taymiyyah wrote about the moon sighting, and he had an argument between this and that. This was 600 years ago. I translated what actually Ibn Taymiyyah said, took it to Gruger. I didn't tell him who had it. The man told me he wants to meet this person because I told him, already somebody died 600 years ago. And he said he was amazed how the Muslims are. By the way, that's why, alhamdulillah, now we are teaching this course called prophetic pedagogy, prophetic art of teaching. And now universities in America are accepting this because we are giving people information that people didn't know, many things. So I gave him this paper, translated it to him. He came to the conference, actually praised that. I said he couldn't believe it, that actually Jaime told us that yes, the birth of the moon can be, but the sighting, and he said there are so many, then, that time, so many things, variables in moon sighting. It depends on the person who sights, because in those days, they don't have this, what they call them. Come on. Secondly, He said it depends on the atmospheric, not only, but the pressure, the atmospheric thing, the contours. And he wrote about 15, 16 things. He says, this is why the sighting of the moon is an issue that has to be discussed. Okay? Now, back to the conference. When they agreed that unanimously the moon can be born, ISNA took a decision then that we will not accept any sighting of the moon before the moon was born. Clear? Because we knew the board, if somebody comes and tells me, by the way, I don't see this issue for your information, like one of the, Ibn Daqiq al-Eid, one of the major fuqaha, he said, if somebody comes to you with an argument, and it's impossible to be there, just reject it, no matter who he is. He gave a beautiful example. He said, if somebody comes to you and he say to you, I find an elephant in a room. He said, don't believe, how come the elephant can get into the room anyway? There's no way you can do it. So there must be something wrong with the parents seeing that. And this is why people will come and say they sighted the moon. But again, they mentioned something else about the moon. They said now, before, you know now, Toronto Airport, WestJet, I think is going on strike now. I think I heard this morning. Now, do you know how many flights take off and land at the Toronto International Pearson Airport a day? Now how many? It's more than 4,000. Simply, yani. And this whole, and now there is this training between Korea and all these things that are happening now. There might be a war now because of Taiwan. They have all these planes and, oh, you don't know what is there. So today, anything can be seen in the space and people think this is the moon. Many things, like satellites, airplanes, all of these things that we have. Anyway, so they said we are going to accept birth of the moon. Still we held on the sighting of the moon. But later on, three papers were published. And they are, alhamdulillah, I'm a reader. I love to gain these things. One of them was by Sheikh Al-Radawi rahmatullah Ali. He had the argument for, he was a middleman. There are people on the extreme that they don't accept any, what you call, math or astrology, like Sheikh bin Baz rahmatullah Ali. He said, we don't care about this. The Prophet said, inna ummatun ummiya, la nahsib wa la naqra, we go and see the moon, we don't deal with this and that and that. And then there is another brother, do you know the Fiqar al-Shah? Anyone who knows him? Oh, subhanAllah, he's on ISNA's website now, because he was supposed to give a lecture somewhere here. Abdul Fakar studied in Al-Azhar, did his PhD here, and then he became one of the key people in Majlis al-Fiqh. He's from Pakistan. He used to be, by the way, the president of ICNA at one time in the early 90s. So they published these three papers. One arguing for people who say you don't accept any math or calculation or anything, go by what the Prophet said and so on. One on the other extreme that this is the era of knowledge, anything can be done by logic and so on. And the middle one is what we took in the beginning. That's why we decided in ISNA for years now that we are not going to accept anyone who says he saw the moon if the moon is not born. After the moon is born, people differ at when the earliest time you can sight the moon. Right? We went even a step further than that. That was the challenge. 1984, when we had this conference, at the time I was the principal of the ISNA school. So one of the professors there, he asked who are in schools. So he gave us a booklet. And this booklet has all the eclipses, including this eclipse today. From there, they knew what time, what city, when is going to start, when is going to finish. And we took that book when we came here after 4 years, right? We knew there is an eclipse and we wanted to test what we were told 4 years back. And actually went, and then they tell you, by the for the moon, there is no problem, but for the sun, they say you don't see the sun without using certain equipment. Otherwise, you might lose your sight. So I told the people in the school, actually, exactly it says, the eclipse in Toronto will start at 1:45, and it will continue until this. So we had this paper 4 years with us. After 4 years came, we monitor it from A to Z. That's now I became very convinced about what these people say. And by the way, the eclipse that happened yesterday is on that record. If you go to the websites, you'll find it. 4 years, they knew it. Now, then at that time, I remember
Who of you know doesn't know Jamal Badawi? Most of us know him, right? The man is very ill, by the way. We keep praying for him. We just keep talking to him almost every week. Jamal Badawi was in the Fiqh Council, and he's a very wise man. So he said, Nihna, we are part of the Muslim world. If we have this knowledge, why don't we take it back to these people? Take this. And they took these astronomers, by the way, from here. And they went to Kuwait, went to Saudi Arabia, they met with Dar al-Iftah, they went to Cairo, met with Al-Azhar, they went to Pakistan, Jam'iyat al-Ulama, they went to India, to Milli. يعني they tried to see what the Muslim, what you call scholars or shuyukh or ulama will say about it. And they got variable answers. يعني they told us when they went to Saudi Arabia, they said, Sheikh bin Baz, rahmatullah alayhi wa sallam, he said, listen, نحن we don't deal with this. We don't come to you and tell you what to do. You people are scholars. You go and do it. You take the responsibility in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But we don't deal with calculations. We don't astronomy. Assalamu alaikum. The good thing, he told them, there is one person, you know, in Allahumma salli ala Muhammad, I'm trying to remember him. He said to him, this is the chairman of the Ulama Council in Kuwait at the time. And he said he had done a lot of research on this and he brought it to us. And he has a book of 500 about pages about the argument for astronomy. We rejected it, but he went back with it. So they went to Kuwait, they went to this, they went to that. They came back here and they said, listen, we didn't get any, what we call consensus on this. But however, they gave us the green light to do what we want to do. You are scholars, you'll be answerable to Allah. Nobody's coming to interfere in what people do in America or whatever it is. Although in those days, they used to accuse us of following Saudi Arabia blindly. Right? But that of course was not true, we knew that. Anyway, so they came here. At the time, I wrote the, what you call the announcement, that ISNA will take this position. And some other like ICNA and later on MAC, MASS and so on, they said we will go by moon sighting in the birth of the moon. We'll still look for the sighting of the moon for that. And later on these papers came, the Professor Taha, rahmatullah alayhi, you know Taha Jabir Umani, he used to be the chair of the International Islamic Thought. He passed away, and actually, by the way, one of the university now established a fund in his name, that's Shenandoah in Washington, D.C., because of his contribution and so on. He said something, listen carefully to his argument. And this is in a book, by the way, in a booklet. He said, if we know scientifically when the moon is born, and we know the moon is born, is there any reason for us to sight the moon? Because if you know the moon is born today, the next day will be Ramadan, the next day falls. And then he put this argument, is sighting the moon an act of worship in itself, the ibadah, or is it a means to know the months? And that was the only means at that time. So what he did, he published this paper. He said, okay. Then they went and met with all these shuyukh. One of the people at the time, you know, Darul Iftah has a group of ulama, they consider them the chair. On the top of them was Sheikh bin Baz, Al-Lihaydan, Sheikh, and most of them passed away. One of them was bin Mani'. Bin Mani' was known, even in Saudi Arabia, even in Dar al-Iftah, even in Lajna Daimah al-Iftah, is an open-minded person. And he listens to people very carefully. So he said, this, he published the paper, by the way, the paper was published in Saudi Arabia in Al-Jazeera, Jazeera, the magazine at that time, not the TV, and then in Sharq al-Awsat, they used to have a news. And I had these clips, we used to bring these things and document them. He said he circulated a letter to all the people who sighted the moon and so on. He said, this information is accurate. We should not accept any sighting before the birth of the moon, hatta by sighting. But later on, people came and they became convinced, you know, this is the time you can sight the moon, case closed. And that's what they have. Now, I brought this out of here because I tell you this one of the moon sighting is something that has to go with it. Now, let's continue. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala again went in Surah Yusuf. He said, إِذْ قَالَ يُوسُفْ إِلَىٰ أَبِيهِ أَبَتْ إِنِّي طَعَنْ You know the famous story. The whole story of Yusuf is based on the dream where he said to his father, قَالَ يَا أَبَتْ إِنِّي رَأَيْتُ أَحَدَ عَشَرَ كَوْكَبًا وَالشَّمْسِ وَالْقَمَرِ رَأَيْتُهُمْ لِي سَاجِدِينَ You know, this is the opening chapter, verses in Surah Yusuf, that he said to his father that I saw this dream and there are 11 stars, the sun and the moon, I saw them prostrating to me. And then, you know, the story is long. We dealt with it when we went through the general tafsir. But his father told him, don't tell this to your brothers, فَيَكِيدُوا لَكْ, like they will envy you and so on. By the way, this is one of the things that the Prophet ﷺ said, because these things come. He said, if you see a good dream, don't tell this dream to people who might envy you. Tell it to people you trust. And if it is a bad dream, don't worry about it. You know the, what you do just to dispel the wife. But he says this. So he said to his son, that's Yaqub to Yusuf, he said, don't tell your brothers about it. And then later on, he had the dream when he went to the prison and with the people who were there. Then the dream about the king who dreamt about the cows and all of this dream that we interpreted. So this is the verse that he says. Now, then we go to Surah Al-Ra'd. That's chapter 13. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Allah الذي رفع السماوات بغير عمد ترونه ثم استوى على العرش وسخر الشمس والقمر كل يجري لأجل مسمى يدبر الأمر يفصل الآيات لعلكم بلقاء ربكم توقنون. So it speaks about the moon, the sighting, and what Allah says. Now again in Surah Ibrahim chapter 14, Allah says, سخر لكم الشمس والقمر دائبين وسخر لكم الليل والنهار because they continue everlast. طيب يقول في سورة النحل سخر لكم الليل والنهار والشمس والقمر والنجوم مسخرات بأمره إن في ذلك لآيات لقوم يعقلون. يقول في سورة الأنبياء وهو الذي خلق الليل والنهار والشمس والقمر كلهم في فلكه يسبحون. سورة الحج ألم تر أن الله يسجد له من في السماوات والأرض والشمس والقمر والنجوم بدل النجوم والجبال والشجر والدواب everything prostrates to Allah سبحانه وتعالى. Now سورة العنكبوت إن سألتهم من خلق السماوات والأرض again وسخر الشمس والقمر ليقولون الله. إن سورة لقمان ألم تر أن الله يولج الليل في النهار ويولج النهار في الليل وسخر الشمس والقمر كل يجري لأجل مسمى إن الله بما تعملون خبير. ده سورة الفجر سورة فاطر يولج الليل في النهار ويولج النهار في الليل أجين وسخر الشمس والقمر كل يجري لأجل مسمى يعني every time الله يتسين ذلكم الله ربكم له الملك. then سورة ياسين والقمر غدرناه منازل حتى عاد كالعرجون القديم. Again, this is an indication that منازل القمر is the ways, the phases which the moon goes. You go also to سورة الزمر. خلق السماوات والأرض بالحق يكور الليل على النهار يكور النهار على الليل سخر الشمس والقمر كل يجري لأجل مسمى ألا هو العزيز الغفور. طيب سورة فصلت ومن آياته الليل والنهار والشمس والقمر. Then Allah said, do not prostrate to the sun or the moon. Then Surah Al-Qamar. Surah Al-Qamar has two things in it. Al-Qamar is chapter 54. The beginning of it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, اقتربت الساعة وانشق القمر. وإن يروا آية يعرضوا ويقولوا سحر مستمر وكذبوا واتبعوا. يعني this is a controversy even among the scholars. Many of the scholars, even Muslims, they say that this انشقاق القمر like that the moon although the verse is clear اقتربت الساعة وانشق القمر they say because Allah said اقتربت الساعة is going to happen to you towards the end of day of judgment but on record there is none of the major signs of the Qiyamah that includes انشقاق القمر according to the hadith which were authentically reported Bukhari Muslim all of this actually this took place at the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam like the moon has actually has been split and they said one was on one fathers طبعا people now because they can't imagine how come the moon is split and so on Allah said it اقترب وانشق القمر and he called it ayah and people denied it and so on and so on anyway this controversy is going until today most of the scholars say yes this is what the prophet said we have to believe in it. But because it's not within our perception this is another thing by the way many Muslims unfortunately we look at things with our prism yani we see things that is possible for us but Allah told us so many things that are too impossible to see I mention this all the time Actually, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, among the challenging signs of him, is naqat salih. Then people told him, get a camel out of this mountain for us. And he called the camel and came and came out. Yani, if Allah can bring a camel out of a mountain, he can split the moon. Why not? سورة البقرة, he speak about this, it's a sorry story, سورة البقرة, and the issue about the people who killed people, and then all what Allah said to them, you want to know who killed this person? Yes. Said, okay, and تذبحوا بقرة. You kill a cow, take some meat with this cow, beat the dead person, he will come back, and he will tell you who killed him. I mean, if you can imagine, I really sometimes think about Muslims, نحن, we want to accept what we can visualize or comprehend, but anything, but actually the mercies of Allah are beyond our perception. This is why this انشقاق القمر, and the surah itself, by the way, if you read it from A to Z, it is a challenge to our intellect, right? And it revolves around the Quran. وَلَقَدْ يَسَّرْنَا الْقُرْآنَ لِلذِّكْرِ فَهَلْ مِن مُدَّكَرٍ. And then he speaks about what happened to the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. يعني for instance, when people shunned the prophets, all of them, نوح, لوط, all of them, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tested these people, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about it. يعني مثلا في Surah Al-Qamar itself, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, they consider some of the prophets are مجانين, قالوا مجنون وازدجر. What did he do? فدعا ربه أني مقلوب فانتصر. People accused him of being lunatic, being out of mind. They tortured him, they put him down. What he did? دعا ربه أني مغلوب. Said to Allah, خلاص. I mean, I cannot do anything. فانتصر. You know what Allah said about that? He said, ففتحنا أبواب السماء بماء منحمر. وفجرنا الأرض عيونا فالتقى الماء على أمر قد قدر وحملناه على ذات ألواح ودثر تجري بأعيننا جزاء لمن كان كفر. Now this verse is not closer to us, and actually it was not closer to us until the tsunami hit. Remember the tsunami? And the tsunami actually was one part of this verse. That was the eruption from within, but nothing came from it. Allah said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala erupted, like فتحنا أبواب. By the way, every time in the Quran Allah speaks about rain, he says نزلنا أنزلنا, these soft words. For this punishment, he said what? فتحنا أبواب, يعني set them loose. Imagine loose heavens and then eruption from under, most of them meet. You know how many people could pass? You remember how many people perished in the tsunami? 146,000 people in about maybe a period of 5 hours. Right? This is just because of the water that came from within. Planes were like going on water, just like small paper planes. يعني. Everything turned upside down. So Allah said, فتحنا أبواب السماء بماء منحمر. فجرنا الأرض عيونا. فالتقى الماء على أمر قد قدر. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after that, he saved him. Anyway, take time and go over Surah Al-Qamar and you get a lot of things. Even if you just read the translation. طيب. Then we go to Surah Al-Rahman. الشمس والقمر والحسبان والنجم والشجر والسودان. And you know it. Surah Nuh. وجعل القمر فيهن نورا. القمر نور. والشمس سراج. This is, يعني, this is the, what we call the accuracy. Where the Quran starts something and you read all the Quran from A to Z. Nothing changes in these things. كلا والقمر. طبعا this is the oath that Allah made in سورة المدثر. In سورة القيامة فإذا برق البصر وخسف القمر وجمع الشمس والقمر يقول الإنسان يومئذ أين المفر. In سورة الانشقاق والقمر إذا اتسق لتركبن طبقا عن طبق. You go to again سورة الشمس. طبعا الشمس القمر إذا تلاها والنور. طيب. Now I mentioned all of this to you because rarely we sit down and think about, because Allah wants us to reflect on all of this. And the science that is now is experimental science. Yani people try things, they did, and day in and day out, people are discovering things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke about. And many people actually are coming to Islam because of this. They get one thing and then say, wow, and this is impossible for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in that desert. The surprising thing is that even people, you know, I was in Kansas City. Kansas has a military base, right? One of the large military bases of the United States. And one time they had about 17 or 18 Saudi, what do you call, army generals. They came to that. They used to come and pray with us. What amazed me is that these people study in these colleges and study science and so on. And the brother was sitting with us in the masjid arguing that we cannot use astronomy to prove the moon side. I said, yeah, Sheikh. And he used this verse, he said, نحن أمة أمية. I told him, didn't you study mathematics? He said, yes. I said, how many universities in Saudi Arabia has mathematics department, mathematics professors? It is not meant, بعدين لا نقرأ. We don't read. We don't do this, we don't do that. Things have to be interpreted within what Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in that context, not in today's context. Because there are things that have changed. Inshallah. Khair. So, I think that took all the time that we have tonight. Khair? Naam, khair. This was triggered by this eclipse of the moon. I thought I really, because these are the occasions that will still be refreshed in your mind. Can I be live by show of hand, if you wouldn't mind? How many of you prayed the prayer tonight, this morning? Only one? See that? Any or two? MashaAllah. Naam. Here? It could be Al-Faruq. By the way, again, one just footnote. Salat al-Kusuf or Khusuf can be prayed at home. Yeah, and you don't have to come to the masjid to do it. You can gather your family and do it with them. You can do it by yourself. The only thing that, because you cannot have a long start from, you can even go for part of it. The sunnah in that you finish, you start from there. And again, this is where it is also permissible. In prayers like Taraweeh, in Salatul Khusuf or Kusuf, that you can read from the Quran. You can use a mishaf. And then you can read it. And these days, actually, the best thing to do is to use your laptop or iPad, right? And then you can just, and you don't have to do, as they say, you don't have to, you can put it and read from the Quran. You can read as much as you can, just in case. I don't know when, because I'm going to check the websites. They'll tell you when the next eclipse is going to be in Toronto. Maybe 5-10 years, I don't know. I don't know what is going to live to see that. But just in case, keep it in the back of your mind so that you can deal with it, inshallah. Khair? I have any quick question, reflection, anything you want? Naam. Allah Alayhi Wasallam. Hey. Yep. Yep. Yeah. 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 Well, the incident that I said didn't happen during the time of Rasulullah, happened afterwards. In those days, there was no astronomy, there was no this, there was that. The only way, and this is how Allah said it, people used to sight the moon. Initially, in Mecca and Medina, people used to sight the moon, even the villages remote, they used to pick a fire. There's so many things that are being said. What happened to this? This man is called Quraib. He was in Sham. And when he came, the ruler there, it was Muawiyah at the time, Ibn Abbas actually asked him, he said to him, when did you sight the moon? He said, we sighted it, he mentioned the day, and he said, we were ordered to fast, and we fasted. Ibn Abbas said, وَلَكِنَّا رَأَيْنَاهُ a day after that. So he said to him, this is the whole issue again of the fiqh of اختلاف المطالع. You know, even the scholars in the old days, they said, there is one matla, and اختلاف. مطلع means if there is one place, all of us follow it. And اختلاف means you have variations. But today it is known. Right now it is 8:30 right here. What's the time in Pakistan? Somebody can tell me now. 5:30 in the morning. What is it in Malaysia? Anyone? 12 hours. Exactly 12 hours. What is that? It's 8:30 in the morning. So it is practically impossible for people to fast in the same time. Impossible. When you are here, right now, we could have been fasting. We are still eating, drinking, going to go home, sleep with our wife, and people already started fasting in Pakistan. Am I right? Or some places like that. So as people travel, people are discon. And even now, alhamdulillah, by phone, I can tell you how many. By the way, there is a website. A brother, mashallah, one of the young brothers, want to prove that at every increment of a second, he used this verse in the Quran, about Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِنَّ اللَّهَ وَمَلَائِكَتَهُ يُصَلُّونَ عَلَى النَّبِيِّ يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا صَلُّوا عَلَيْهِ وَسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا اللَّهُمَّ صَلِّ وَسَلِّمْ عَلَى نَبِيِّنَا مُحَمَّدٍ. He said, at every increment of a second, there is somebody who's sending his peace and praise about Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Just take the azan. And you can imagine if you have a world map in front of you right now, and then you can link with these people, you'll find that every second there is an azan somewhere. Am I right or wrong? Every minute somebody saying, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammad al-Rasulullah. Right or wrong? Now we can put this in front of us. You know, this GPS and so on, saying, they make it easier for you to see all the things that were there. For the thing that we are saying in those days, this was not. And this is why things that were used then were perfectly all right. That was the only way that people can know when the most cited or not. Now we can know more. No questions asked. And this is what I kept in the beginning of this series about the parables of the Quran. Remember when he spoke about Surah Sad? Do you remember it? I hope you know the type. This is an amazing surah. A chapter in the Quran, the name of the surah is a letter, Sad. Right? The beginning verse, Sad wal Quran al-dhikr, bal alladhina kafaru fi 'izzatin wa shiqaq. The whole surah is about the Quran. The last, if I go for this, we're going to stay until tomorrow. By the way, Surah Sad, remember, took up 2 months to finish it. Here, right here. Time. The last verse in Surah Sad, the beginning is Sad wal Quran al-dhikr bal alladhina kafaru fi 'izzatin wa shiqaq. The last verse, the last, ends with ولا تعلم, I think it's 88, right? 88 verses. ولا تعلمن نبأه بعد حين. ولا تعلمن, actually تعلمن is you will know with the assertion. You call it التوكيد. تعلمن means you will surely, truly, really, indeed you will know. نبأه, what the Quran is talking about. After some time. بعد حين. Simple. They said when this revelation came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, one of the Sahaba, and the Sahaba were quick, but if you see the question they used to ask, you trace it, they're very smart. They didn't let anything go. So one of them said, Ya Rasulullah, didn't you tell us all the Quran by the time was finished, everything done, and so on? He said, yes. He said to him, what is it that Allah is saying? You will know it surely after some time. Genuine question, right? They said the Prophet paused and they felt him becoming very emotional. He didn't answer the person directly. They said, he said, wa shawqah li ikhwani li lamma ya'tu ba'd. The man, you ask him, where is, and he says, I long for my brothers. We didn't come yet. One of the companions said to him, Ya Rasulullah, أولسنا إخوانك, aren't you your brother? Said, no, بل أنتم أصحابي. So I called them Sahaba. You are my companions. And the difference between a companion and a brother, companion is the person who is in your company. An akh is anyone. I can have a brother here. There. So the Prophet said, these brothers, you are my companions. They used to eat with the Prophet, right? They used to drink with the Prophet. They used to breathe behind the Prophet. They used to go to the janazah with the Prophet. He used to visit the sick, visit the people in their homes, visit this and that. So these are people, his companions. He said, my brothers, that Allah, this what I long for, are people who are going to come generations after. I hope you are among them. They didn't see me. Did anyone of you see the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام? Absolutely not. Even the Prophet for us is ghaib. We didn't sit with the Prophet. We didn't interact with the Prophet. We didn't sleep with the Prophet. We didn't drink with the Prophet. We didn't. He said, these are the brothers who are going to come generations after me. They didn't see me, yet they will believe in me and they will love me. These are the brothers that Allah will reveal the Quran for. Does it make sense to you? And this is what we are saying, all what we are saying today. Yani today now, we read the Quran, we see what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we reflect on it and say, subhanallah. This is what the Prophet said. Many of these were not accessible to people. Things that we know today, people didn't know them. So that's how things changed. And this is why even scholars 600 years ago, Ibn al-Qayyim, came with this, they call it the golden rule. He says, تتغير الفتوى بتغير الزمان والمكان. He said, every generation certain limited knowledge. Now we have a wider knowledge. Knowledge that you can verify, that you can experiment with, you can actually know what you are doing, and then within the same range of the thing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying. Khair? Khair. Let's say. Sorry? Alhamdulillah, may Allah give us more. When we don't know what the coming generations are going to find. طيب نسأل سبحانك اللهم بحمدك نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك. Again, I'm going to repeat. We are going to be, inshallah, meeting after عشاء, most probably until 8:30, and then I think, yeah, we went a little bit, 5 minutes or so. Assalamu alaikum. How are you?